The principle of sufficient reason is Leibniz's conception that every truth, every fact, and every event has a sufficient reason that explains why it is the way it is. Nothing is arbitrary. The principle of sufficient reason predates Leibniz, but there is no philosopher who pushed the analysis of this principle as profoundly as Leibniz did. In his formulation of the principle of sufficient reason, Leibniz starts with a simple and intuitive premise. The way we reason is based on two principles. First is the principle of contradiction, through which we judge that which includes a contradiction to be false, like the proposition, "I drew a square triangle," and that which opposes a contradiction to be true. Second is the principle of sufficient reason, through which every true fact necessitates the existence of a sufficient reason that explains why that fact is true. Leibniz notes that many times those reasons are unknown to us. And this is a remark he makes that is very important to keep in mind. He argues that every truth, every fact, and every event requires a sufficient reason, and he qualifies the sufficient reason as an a priori proof, an a priori proof that demonstrates the causal order of how this is the way it is. So far, the principle of sufficient reason seems to be simple and concerns everyday life. But Leibniz intends to utilize it to present a metaphysical stand. This becomes apparent when he writes that there are sufficient reasons that explain the existence of everything, but that those reasons are often unknown to us. Nothing happens without a reason. This shows that Leibniz takes the PSR, the principle of sufficient reason, as a general rule that applies to everything that exists. For every fact F, there must be sufficient reason why F is the case. This seems to be intuitive. We always search for reasons and explanations of how things are the way they are. But when you present this principle as a hard rule that applies to everything, to absolutely everything that exists, it starts to have radical implications. The most pronounced implications are the identity of indiscernibles, the relativity of space and time, and the existence of one single uncaused cause, God. For a good grasp of the principle of sufficient reason, there is another theory of Leibniz that is important to understand, and that is Leibniz's theory of truth. In his essay First Truths, Leibniz writes, "In every true proposition, the notion of the predicate is in some way included in the subject." Leibniz identifies two types of true propositions. There are propositions whose truths are explicit, and there are propositions whose truths are implicit. The propositions whose truths are explicit are in the form of X is X or X is not minus X. For instance, my father is my father. Or a male is not a female. You see, in these examples, the predicate, what comes after the verb, is already included or contained in the subject. This type of statement is called an identity statement. It is also called a necessary truth. But then Leibniz theorizes something very bold and extreme. He says that every true proposition is true because of this reason. Now consider the statement, "My mother made a cake." This is not an identity statement because it is not in the form of X is X or X is not minus X. This statement requires us to proceed with conceptual analysis. Making a cake is not clearly contained in the subject, "my mother." Yet, we should get to a point where we show that making a cake is already included in the subject, "my mother." And how we do that is through conceptual analysis. This leads to the conclusion that all true statements are analytic. the difference between necessary truths, X is X statements, and contingent truths, X is Y statements, is that the analysis of necessary truths requires a finite number of steps, while the analysis of contingent truths requires an infinite number of steps. But what is this conceptual analysis? For Leibniz, conceptual analysis is the replacement of a subject by all its properties. So if someone were to know every bit of information about the subject, my mother, the fact that she's a woman, her entire history from the day she was born to the moment she made the cake, her genetic properties, her state of mind, if someone were to know all there is to know about the subject my mother, then the predicate making a cake at that particular moment would be included and contained in the subject my mother. But the listing of all the properties of a subject, the conceptual analysis of the subject, is not feasible by human minds. It requires an infinite number of steps that only God, in his infinite omniscience, can achieve. Now, how does Leibniz's theory of truth relate to the principle of sufficient reason? The idea that every effect is caused by a cause utilizes the same concept of containment that we've seen in Leibniz's theory of truth. The relationship between a cause and its effect is similar to the relationship between the predicate and the subject. Causes engender effects that are already contained in the essence of the causes. There are examples where this relationship is pellucid, like when parents give birth to a baby. The baby is clearly included in the essence of the parents because it comes out of the sperm and the egg of the two parents, or honey that comes out of a bee. But there are other situations where this relationship is not as pellucid and where we have to proceed with conceptual analysis. The ultimate purpose of conceptual analysis is to demonstrate that whenever there is a relationship of causation where X causes Y, Y is already contained in the essence of X. Now let's talk about two implications of the principle of sufficient reason, the identity of indiscernibles. It is Leibniz's argument that it is impossible for two things to be exactly the same. When two or more things look the same, they are not, according to Leibniz's law. But what is a thing? A thing is a set of properties. When we say that no two things are exactly the same, we mean that no two things have exactly the same set of properties. Because if they had the same set of properties, they wouldn't be two things, they would be one thing. And while this concept is easily accepted with many things like rocks, flowers, trees, mountains, people, even twins are told apart by their friends and families, but there are other things that seem to challenge this concept, like clones and molecules. Two molecules of water seem to be the same. But this is solved by Leibniz's definition of properties. There are two types of properties. There are intrinsic properties and extrinsic properties. Intrinsic properties are related to what makes the thing, and extrinsic properties are related to where the thing is located in space. So while two molecules of water are the same in terms of what they're made of, they are not the same because they're not located in the same spot in space. So when those two molecules are located in different spots in space, this makes the thisness of each of them different from the thisness of the other. The fact that one of them is located differently in a different spot in space changes what it is, changes how it behaves, and changes how it feels, if you want to go panpsychist. What pushes Leibniz to negate the existence of indistinguishable objects is that God would not create two things that have exactly the same set of properties because there wouldn't be sufficient reason to. The final point in this video is how the principle of sufficient reason proves the existence of God. We have established, according to Leibniz, that everything that exists is caused by a cause. This implies that either there is an infinite regress of causes, like your parents gave birth to you, their parents gave birth to them, their parents' parents gave birth to them, and you go like that infinitely. Or that there is a non-contingent being that is responsible for all causation. The idea of infinite regress of causes does not seem to be very logical. This leaves us with the idea that there is a non-contingent being, an uncaused cause that is responsible for everything. But still, there is another problem. How do we know that there is only one uncaused cause, one non-contingent being, or that there are many non-contingent beings and that each one of them is responsible for a group of contingent beings? Let's consider the two possibilities. First, there is only one non-contingent being and he is responsible for all causation. Second possibility, there are many non-contingent beings and that each one of them is responsible for one group of contingent beings. One of them is responsible for fire, another is responsible for water, another for dogs, and each one is responsible for a different group. Leibniz argues for the existence of only one single non-contingent uncaused cause, God, because he says that if there were different non-contingent beings, each one of them responsible for a group of contingent beings, difference and distinctions would be apparent. But the world is not like that. There is harmony that pervades all existing things and all contingent beings interact with each other. This is proof for monotheism. This video has reached its end. Until we meet again, have a great day.